All right, here we are with lab 9. I've made a new R markdown document for it. I've copied in the assignment, and I've already done this. Actually, if we scroll down, we could look at all the code. We're going to go through it for the solution video. So I'm not going to live code this one. And I've produced a reproducible analysis. That's one of our goals for the semester-long project, to be able to obtain some data from a psychological experiment, load it into R, run all the analyses, and then report it. So for example, in this case, we are obtaining data from this paper right here. And I did that, and I loaded it into R, and this paper happens to do two chi-square tests, and that's the topic of lab 9. So I loaded all of that into here, and I did the chi-square tests, and I also did another binomial test that was part of the analysis. And as you can see, here is the original results from the authors in the paper. I just copied it right out of the results section directly. And down here is my reproducible report. And if we compared the values, we'll see that I was able to attain the same values that the authors obtained. And I wanted to give you all an example of some of the things that will be a component of the semester-long project here. So that's why we're starting to do lab assignments that involve all the same steps. So there's a few things to mention about this paper before we get started. And I'll just interject all of these things in as we go along. So first of all, this paper can be obtained through the Zotero shared library that I mentioned in class. Also, you could look it up and probably download it through the Brooklyn College Library. And if you get this paper, which I got right here, here it is, you'll see it's a new paper from 2020. It also has this blue badge, which means that it has open data. And so it's really nice of the authors to share this data with us so that we can do things like run this lab and see if we could reanalyze it, learn about chi-square tests. When you see the blue badge, it's not necessarily clear where in the paper you'll find the link. However, it's becoming, I guess, a little bit more common, at least in my opinion, that you'll see this at the end. So I scrolled to the bottom, and here is the link right here. It links to an OSF repository. So if you go to this link, you'll be taken to the Open Science Framework website. This website hosts many different repositories, many of which contain open data for other psychological research projects. In this case, the data is in this XLSX file, so you could download that. And I've already done that. I have downloaded it into a folder that I made specifically for Lab 9 as a location to save the data, and here it is. If we kept reading, we'd see that it's an SLSX file. So we could open this up in Excel and take a look at the data. Before we do that, I'm going to mention one more thing, and that is, well, actually two things. First of all, let me briefly describe what this experiment is about. And then I will talk about the tests that were done to evaluate the data. So this is the first experiment is pretty straightforward. They do a nice job of summarizing it right here. So basically, this is a free choice experiment. There's infants involved. And each infant will first choose between two equally appealing toys. Do you want this toy or this toy? So the infant then chooses one of the toys. And then they're given a second choice. They're shown the unchosen toy, the one they didn't want, and also a new toy. In the second choice, what is measured is whether the infants choose the novel toy or if they chose the previously unchosen toy. So if you break it down, we've got 21 infants. They're between 10 and 20 months old. If we skip to the results, here we see the first major result. 16 of 21 infants chose the new toy instead of the toy that they didn't choose the first time. So 16 of 21. They report a two-tailed binomial test that would be appropriate here. They want to know the probability that you could get a 16 or greater by chance alone. It's a two-tailed test, so they add on the complementary probability. So we'll do this in R. We'll have to get their data and see if it's true that 16 of 21 infants did choose the new toy. So presumably that's in the data somewhere. If we can get 16, we can use these numbers and put them into one of the binomial functions in R, calculate these probabilities. I'm just going to skip the confidence interval stuff and the relative risk ratio. Last, there's some chi-square tests. And that's why we're looking at this paper, because it seemed like they would have some data we could use. And they're pretty straightforward, although I believe that one of them was done incorrectly. So here we have it. A chi-square test of independence indicated no significant effect of age or gender on infants' choices. And then here's the result. Chi-square, 19 degrees of freedom, 21 infants. There's a value of 18.24 and an associated probability. So this chi-square test is presumably for the first thing here, age. And this chi-square test is for the gender test. I was able to reproduce all of these values, and as we'll kind of discover as we step through it, this one here is a little funny, and in my opinion, the chi-square test was applied incorrectly in this situation. It's not that the values are wrong, it's just that the data shouldn't have been applied to this particular test. So as we will keep those, I will discuss those things as we attempt to reproduce the analysis. In this case, we'll arrive at least in my answer for this question is, I've arrived at a successful reproduction. I have reproduced all of the analysis. And at the same time, at least one of these, in my opinion, probably shouldn't have been done. So if you have problems trying to figure out how to do the chi-square test on age and the infant's choices, don't worry too much about that. And you can fast forward to what I think the authors did here. All right, so moving on, let's get back to solving this problem. First of all, we're going to read in the data. Now, we haven't even looked at the data yet. So what is it exactly that we're reading in? It's always a good idea to take a look at what's going on. So here's the XLS file. I'm just going to view it. I've actually added two things here. That was my bad. Here's what would happen on your computer, probably. I'm just going to make this a little bit smaller. So we have an Excel file. And, okay, it's got, what's going on? There's 190 rows. There's some columns. And it looks like this is all the data from experiment 1. This is all the data from experiment 1B, 2, 2B, 3, 3B, 4. Okay, this is pretty sensible. If you look at the paper, there's a 1A, 1B, 2A, 2B, 3, 3A, 3B. And 4. All right. So we're only focusing on the data for experiment 1. Let's take a closer look at that. Remember, there's 21 infants, so there's Each of these rows refers to a different infant. We've got codes for age. It looks like age is coded in terms of months down to two decimal places. That will become an issue later on for the chi-square test of independence. We've got gender codes, female and male here. And it looks like a bunch of information about what happened in the experiment. So it's always kind of fun to reconstruct what might have happened in the experiment looking at the data. So it looks like the first participant was presented with a black rectangle and an orange arch as the two toys, and they chose the black rectangle. That's how I'm interpreting this infant's choice on the first trial would be this one. And then on the second trial, I guess they would have been shown the orange arch again and a new thing, the green cube. And this infant chose option C, referring to the green cube, the new toy. They've added a column, infant chose C, and whenever they did, it looks like the column is coded as a 1. So I'm guessing, just looking at this, that 16 of the infants chose C, because that's what they said in the paper. So I could just quickly sum this up. I mean, this is using it, doing an Excel thing here. We got 16. Great. All right. So I got a sense of the data. Let's bring it into R. Now, I've got some stuff commented out here. We can do it using the XLSX package. And here's what that looks like. We get the data in. Oops, where is it? Here it is. There it is. But we also read in a bunch of NAs. So I'm not sure what's going on there, if that's something to do with that Excel file, something to do with this particular way of reading in Excel files. Also, when we did that on my computer, I got some weird warnings and stuff. This made me feel a little bit annoyed, and I didn't want to deal with Excel. So what I did instead was I converted this tape, or the, all of the data here, to a CSV file. That's a comma-separated value file. You could do that in Excel just by save as, and then turning it into a CSV file right here. There's multiple ways to do it. So I just did that transformation. And here's what the CSV file looks like. So the first row is the header names, and then we've got all the data. And as you can see, each piece of data is separated by a comma. So that's why it's called a comma separated value CSV file. And we can read that in to R using read.csv. So I did that, and here we have the data, and it doesn't have that weird NA stuff. Okay, so we succeeded in getting the data in. Great. The next thing I want to do is restrict the data only to experiment one. I'm going to use the dplyr library to do that. So I'm going to run a filtering operation. I'm going to say keep only the rows where the column experiment number equals 1. And experiment number here, this column codes all the different experiments. And I'm storing all of this in the E1 data variable. So now this variable only has 21 rows, just the number of rows for each of the infants in experiment one. So the first thing that the authors did was conducted a binomial test. They wanted to know how many infants chose the new toy. And that data is available in this last column. infants who chose the new toy got a 1. So I just want to add up all the numbers in that column. And I could do that right here. Those are all the numbers in the column. And if I add them up, I get a 16. And if I want to know how many total infants there are, I could get the length of that column to get 21. So I have 16 and 21 stored in sum and total, sum C and total C. And now I want to do a binomial test. So here's how I did it. This is written, let's try to make this a little bit more clear in the writing of this. So first of all, if we run this, I get 0.026. And if we check the author's work, they also reported a 0.026 on 16 out of 21. So I saved all of that in the binomial P formula. I guess I want to explain just a little bit what's going on here. So if you take the P binome function and you put in 16 out of 21, so Q equals 16, and size equals 21, and the probability, let's say, is 50-50. And the lower tail equals false, so this will be the probability of getting greater than 16, you get a 0.003. To make it a two-tail test, we have to double this, but we only get 0.007. And that is not the same value that the authors got. If we remember, the P binome function is very particular about how it's computing probabilities. If you set lower tail to false, it computes the probability of getting a value greater than the Q value. If you set the lower tail to true, calculates the probability of getting a value of Q or less than Q. So it includes this value. So we'd like to include the value. And the only way to really do that is to say, well, 21 minus 16, that is the difference between we have 16 out of 21, and the difference between that is 5. So a comparable difference on the other side is 5 out of 21. That would be, if we take 21 and divide by 2, we have 10.5 as the expected middle value, and 16 is 5.5 away from that, and 10.5 minus 5 is the same distance away from that. So, sorry, slowing down here a little bit. It's Thursday at 4, and it's getting a little bit late. So, this one is a 5. Anyways, I'm setting this as 5 and computing the lower tail, and that gives us 0.013. So it's like saying, okay, what's the probability of getting 5 or less and 16 or more? Because the binomial distribution is symmetrical, we could take the probability of getting 5 or less, which is the same as the probability of getting 16 or more, and we just multiply it by 2. And when we do that, we get the binomial value that was reported in the paper. And so instead of by hand putting in 21 minus 16, I've done the total minus the sum. And I've put the total here as well. Okay. Let's move on. The next thing is to do the test of independence for the age and gender variables. I'm going to start with the gender variable because that one is easier to do, and I think it was done correctly. So that's this one right here. First of all, let's flip over to Excel. I've made a little Excel table to look at here, just to overview what we're doing, right? So we have some male infants and some female infants, and they either chose the new toy, which is choice C, or they didn't. I think I've got these values wrong here. I think the outcome of the experiment was something like this. 16 of them chose C and out of 21. And the breakdown, I think, was 8 and 3 for males and 8 and 2 for females. I might have that mixed up. Let's go. We'll double check that. So those are the observed counts. We need to calculate the marginal counts. We need to create our expected values, assuming independence. And then we need to compute the difference between the observed and expected values and square them and add them all up. And if you do that, you'll get a 0.15. And that's what the authors got. 0.15. So the numbers of degrees of freedom here is 1 because there's 2 minus 1 degrees of freedom for the columns, and there's 2 minus 1 degrees of freedom for the rows. And so 1 times 1 is 1. Another way of thinking about this is there's 4 values here, but only one of them is free to vary because we've estimated these two sums here and these two sums. And if we were to go and say, okay, 16, 5, 11, and 10, first of all, let's say this number was a 6. All right. Now, this number could be any number. It could be a 1, could be a 2, but let's say it's a 6. I'm just made that up. As soon as we know this number has to be 16, and this one has to be 5, and this one also has to be, well, this one has to be 0, doesn't it? So these other three numbers became defined as soon as this one was defined. So these three had no degrees of freedom, and this one had degrees of freedom. So there's 1 degree of freedom here. So we take this chi-square value, and we compare it to a chi-square distribution with degrees of freedom 1. And we'll do that in a moment. When the authors did that, they found the probability of getting this value or larger was 0.696. So let's do all of this in R. When I did this in Excel, even when I was going through and doing it by hand, I made a bunch of mistakes, but I think I got the right answer at the end. But in doing all of this stuff by hand, I didn't preserve all of the steps in a reproducible fashion. So we could do that in R. I'm going to load up the tidyR package. We're going to use this for a step in a moment. So you might not have this installed, but it's useful for a number of reasons. And let's talk about them for this problem. So I'm going to create, what my goal here is, I want to create a table, a contingency table, that looks like this. So a 2x2, it's got the observed frequency counts. That's what my goal is. However, the data is in this format, right? So we're trying to basically coerce or transform this data. I like to think about this like a Rubik's Cube problem. So I want to rotate the data and do lots of things to it until I've solved the Rubik's Cube and I've made the new table that I want. So we can do this by using a series of pipes. I'm sending the data into a grouping operation, and I'm going to group by the gender column, and you know that has male or female in it, and I'm going to group by the column that codes 1 or 0 whether the infant chose C. And then I'm going to create a new variable called counts, and I'm going to use the n function in there. What that does is it counts up each of the occurrences, and let's see what happens if we do just this part. So what we get is a new data frame. It's in a long format, so it shows us here that there, for females who didn't choose C, there was 3 of them. Females who did choose C, there's 8 of them. And 2 males didn't, and 8 males did. So these are the 4 frequency counts. And that reminds me that I got this wrong when I answered those, when I put those numbers in there. It's males 8-2, females 8-3. Okay, so I don't want these numbers to be in a column. I want them to be in a 2x2 matrix, and I want these factors to be the names of the columns, etc. We can use the pivot wider function to make long data wider. And to do that, we provide information about the names we want to be in the new columns and the values we want to be inside the cells of the matrix. So I want the names of the columns to be, I'm looking at the wrong thing here. I want the names of the columns to be taken from the gender variable, and I want the values to be taken from the counts that we just made. So if we run all of this, this is what we get. We get something that looks like this. And so it's actually reversed from what we were looking at over here in terms of the top part is not choice. The top part is male-female. So we have female-male, actually, because the alphabetical order is there, F then M. But the relationships are all the same. So 3 females didn't choose C, 8 did. 2 males didn't choose C, 8 did. Great. So in this step, we're just making the table that we want to use. Now, this table officially is not exactly what we want. This will definitely happen in R sometimes. So this table has 2 observations of 3 variables. If you read that here, the number of observations are the number of rows. So there's 2 rows and there's 3 variables. It's treating this first one, this first column, which is in my mind is names. For 0 is names for not choosing C, and 1 means choosing C. So in my head, I'm treating this as a factor, just like F and M are a factor for female and male. But officially in R, this is actually a 2x3 matrix. And the numbers I really want are just these 4 right here. So I did a little bit of operation on that variable here, and I took all of the rows, but only columns 2 and 3. So if I do this, I just isolate the values 3, 2, 8, and 8. So that's what I'm doing there. And as we discussed in lab, if you have a matrix, a 2 by 2, for example, you can just put it into the chi-square test function just like this, and it will do the rest of the work for you. So if we ran that, we should expect to find what the authors reported. However, this doesn't look like that to me. So for example, the chi-square value that we found in Excel was 0.15, and the chi-square value right here is this really small number, e-3.2, and the p-value is 1. So this is, you know, you might be thinking, what is going on? Well, what's going on is a few things. First of all, the person who wrote this function has made a warning. They're suggesting that the chi-squared approximation may be incorrect in this case. And in class, we talked about cases when expected frequencies are less than 5. And if you looked at this Excel table, you would see that some of the expected frequencies here are less than 5. So there might be an argument that the data are insufficient to do a chi-square test in this situation. Nevertheless, there's another issue, and that is when this chi-square test was conducted, R automatically does something. It applies something called the Yates continuity correction. Now, I didn't ask it to do that. What I'd like to do is attempt to reproduce what the authors did. And so I'm going to do the calculation of chi-square by hand, or more directly. I've saved all the values in the gender_XSQ variable. And if you look at that variable with a dollar sign, you can see there's lots of stuff in there. The observed values are right here. The expected values are right here. So we could simply subtract each of these to get the differences. Then we could square them. These are the steps we performed in Excel. And then we could divide by the expected values and sum everything together. And if we did that, we get 0.15. That's what the authors got. So I'm calling this the uncorrected chi-square. And if we use our chi-square probability function and put in a value of 0.15, and we ask, and we also define the degrees of freedom to be 1, and we set lower tail to false, so we're now asking, what's the probability of getting a value larger than 0.15 on a chi-square distribution with degrees of freedom 1, we will get 0.6959. And the authors reported 0.696. So we got the same number. So we successfully reproduced the analysis there. We've saved it all in this variable. Finally, let's turn to the chi-square for age. And this is where things get a little weird. I looked at this the first time and looked at the 19 there, and I thought, a chi-square distribution with degrees of freedom 19, that sounds kind of weird. I wondered if there was you know, 19 is pretty close to 21, which is the total number of infants. And sometimes, you know, maybe they misreported this and did something like a goodness of fit test, where you would take the degrees of freedom being n minus 1. So 21 minus 1 is close to 19, but it's 20. So, you know, and they said they did a chi-square test of independence, which requires two variables, two categorical variables. So just like, well, let's look at this. So for example, with the gender test, we had the variable male and female, two categories on that and two categories on the choice. So that makes it 2 by 2. You know, if we were considering the age of the infants, I was expecting something like this here, so that we'd have our two choices. You either chose the novel toy or not, and then, you know, you're going to have young and old infants, maybe. That would be a 2 by 2. And the degrees of freedom on that is going to be 1. So I was, you know, this is why I was confused. Like, how do you get degrees of freedom of 19? Now, I think I figured out what the authors did. What I have here, I've copied out from the data. These are the ages in months for each of the infants. And these are the choices they made. So that's just the same numbers here. And, you know, there's 21 infants. I suspect, well, let's see here. Let's sort these numbers from smallest to largest. Okay, so we do that. We've got all of our infants here. Because age is a continuous variable, it's been coded down to decimal, so these are in terms of months. You'd expect almost every single infant to be slightly different age than, but look right here what happens. There's two infants who are actually remarkably 11.66 months old. The same age in continuous time. And I don't think there's any other identical ages. Yeah, no. There isn't. So I believe what happened is the authors treated this variable as a factor, as a categorical variable, splitting, basically treating each infant as its own category. And so if we do that, let's see what we have to do in Excel to do this. We're gonna have chose C and didn't do that, not C. Now all of these infants here, they chose C. They're all coded as 1. All of these ones obviously didn't, because there's only one choice, so it has to be 0. Now this infant, they chose 0, right? So I'm going to move the 0 over here. And I'm actually going to just delete this number, because there's two infants that were 11.66. And oops, I almost made a mistake. There's two infants who are 11.66. One of them chose the 0, so they get a 1 over here. And one of them chose C. Sorry, one of them didn't choose C, one of them did. So there's two. There's, right? Now this infant chose C, so they get a 1. These two, they didn't. They chose not C, so I'm putting the 1 over there. These ones all chose 1. This one didn't. This one did. This one didn't. Okay. So this table here, I think, is the table. Somebody made a table like this and probably tried to do a chi-square test on it. This table has 20 different values on the age axis and two choices. So my guess is 20 minus 1 is 19, and 2 minus 1 is 1. 1 times 19 is 19, And I believe that, I mean, that makes sense of why there's a degrees of freedom of 19. This is the problem with the data here and trying to do a chi-square test on it. And the problem is that basically the most of the table is missing data, right? So there's more cells in the table. There's 20 times 2, all that adds up to 40. 40 total cells, but there's only 21 infants. Even if you had 40 infants and one in each of these different ages, just like this situation here, even there, your expected frequencies, if they were independent, would be this. It would be all ones. There's not enough data to even have an expected frequency of one, because there's only one person. So, the bottom line here is, if you force your counts into a sit, let me put it another way, if you treat each individual participant as their own category, and they can only make one choice in a two alternative forced choice situation, then the data will effectively look like this. Every person will do the first option and not the other option, or vice versa. So every row will contain a one or a zero. In this one case, there is two people who happen to be this one age, so that doesn't apply here. And I think you'll find that if your table looks like this, then the degrees of freedom that you calculate will just basically be adding up all of your ones. Anyway, I don't want to continue to, I think, talk about why this doesn't make sense, but let's do it in R anyways, just to see if we can reproduce it to sort of figure out exactly what must have been done or what might have been done. So I take the data and I group it by age and I get the counts. And if we do this, here's what we see happen. Let's see. I'll do this whole thing. All right. Okay, so we have infants in these different age groups. However, we get mostly missing data, right? That's kind of what the data actually looks like. For example, there's an infant who is 20.01 months old. There's only one of them. So you can, if you're going to only have one count, it's either going to go here and not there. So this is not a value because there can only be one count. So because there's only one infant making one choice in almost every single column here, there's mostly NAs in this table. Okay, well, I'm trying to force the chi-square test here. We can try to do that by converting all of those NAs to zeros. So if I do that, we replace all the NAs with zeros. And then again, I don't want this first column because that's actually the codes for whether you chose C or not. So I'm taking columns 2 to 21 and converting them to a matrix. So now we have the same count data that I produced in Excel here. It's just not going this way. It's going left to right. And we can throw that into a chi-square test. And when we do that, we get a chi-square value of 18.24. And that's the value that the authors reported. And so, yes, this chi-square value can be created and hypothetically evaluated on a chi-square distribution with 19 degrees of freedom. And the p-value for that is 0.506. So that is also what the authors reported. But there's a red flag here. The chi-square approximation may be incorrect. Also, if we were just to inspect this a little bit, you can sort of see, start seeing some of the problems. So the here's the observed values. Whoops. There we are. Right? Now, just as a general idea with a chi-square test, what you want to do is you want to see, are your observed frequencies different from the kind of frequencies you would expect, let's say, by chance or given that all your numbers are independent. And it's really odd when your statement about your theoretically observed frequencies have zeros in them, essentially. So let's look at the expected. Now, this, I think, just illustrates sort of how ridiculous this situation is. So we're computing in this chi-square test the expected value for this infant, because this is just comes down to one infant who is 10 months old, that their expected value was 0.76 for this choice and a 0.23 for that choice. Oh. I don't know. I'm not doing a very good job of, I think, explaining what is odd about this use of the chi-square test. I think the bottom line is they didn't have very many infants. They treated each infant as their own category. And by doing that, it's basically... I'm not sure which specific misuse is going on here, but maybe if they'd done something like this, like bin the data into younger infants and older infants and then create a 2x2, maybe they could address this question. I think the bottom line for me is there just really wasn't enough subjects to adequately use a chi-square test to address a question about independence. But that's kind of here nor there. We were successfully able to reproduce all of the values. That the bigger goal here wasn't to get into the weeds of a particular paper and or question whether the authors are justified in the choices they made. Our specific goal was to bring the data into R, write some scripts that accomplish the reanalysis, save all of the analyses in variables, and then print them out. So for example, at the end of this, what I've done is I've just gone into the original paper from right here, and I just copied all of this. So this is a direct copy of what the authors wrote. These are the values I'm trying to reproduce. For each of the values, except for this part, what I did was written reproducible version. So for example, instead of writing 16, I did a little R code snippet and I've referenced the variable sum C that contains the 16. And for the 21, I've referenced the variable total C, which contains 21. And for the 76.2%, I do 21 divided by 16, and so on. So for each of the little components, so when I get to the binomial test, or the chi-square test, I use R code snippets to point to the relevant variables that are storing all of the data. And so that means when I knit the document, think about all the things that are happening when I press knit. I am loading in the data. I am running all of this code that is doing specific things in terms of analysis. I'm storing all of the data. And then at the end, I'm writing it out in a reproducible way such that if somebody else obtained this R Markdown document along with the data file, they could press knit and it would reproduce the analysis that I did. And this is a way of being transparent about the ways that you are transforming the data as you bring it in and what you're actually doing in terms of tests on the data when you report them. We'll start refining this process across the remaining labs. So for example, here, we've got some really long numbers. We're not rounding appropriately. There's a few times where we do the rounding. So for example, this number, I rounded using the round function. Where's that? Right here. And I just got a little lazy and didn't do that for all these other ones. We'll also learn about some really handy functions from the PapaJaw package that automate some of this part for you. So that's it for now, and we'll see you next week.